Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Good morning. Welcome to First Christian Church. My name is Reverend Paul Carpenter, and as the senior pastor of this congregation, we welcome you to worship this morning. If you would, during our morning welcome and also our first few hymns and gathering time, to take the black get-to-know-you pads on the center aisle, fill them out, pass them to your neighbor. There are encouragement cards in there, and if you fill out an encouragement card, it looks like a postcard, and you throw it in the offering plate, the church will actually send the postage out for you. And I got an encouragement card this week in the mail. I didn't realize that's how it worked. It's very nice to receive one. So if there's somebody you would like to encourage, please fill that out, put their address on it, and we will make sure it gets to the right person. We're glad you're with us today. May you all please stand and join us in praising the one true God.
And mercy, slow to anger, and filled with unfailing love and faithfulness. Teach me thy way, O Lord, so that I may walk in truth. So come, let us worship God together. Give thanks to thee, O Lord, my God, for great is your love toward us.
Thank you.
has the peace of Christ.
I'd like to invite forward Sandra Foster. God bless you. Sandra contacted me this week. This was happened to be this past Friday her 80th birthday. And in addition to that, well, we can clap for that, can't we? In addition to that, Sandra mentioned that God had been at work in her heart and cleaning her up and changing some things and that whole process of the Holy Spirit finding someone and reclaiming them for the gospel. And Sandra came forward for baptism around the age of 10, and she contacted me because she was seeking to be rebaptized, and we had a good conversation on the phone, and I mentioned that I'm a little shaky on rebaptizing someone because your baptism, your first one, took. It's completely valid. And so instead of a baptism, she decided to come forward and reaffirm her vows into Jesus Christ. And we would reenact what Jesus Christ did for his disciples. He didn't rebaptize them. Instead, he washed their feet. And together with Brad, our chair of the elders, we'd like to offer this to Sandra, then have you all please join us in prayer. Sandra, do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and do you profess him as Lord and Savior? God bless you. Please have a seat. Let's pray. Father, we ask a blessing over this water. Just as we pray over the waters of baptism to reclaim us for your kingdom, we pray over these waters, Lord, that you would use this to reaffirm the faith of Sandra. We pray for those in our congregation who are longing for this renewal. We pray that this would transfer to them as well, and that each of us could remember our vows to walk with you. We pray that this would be our primary covenant upon this earth, that we would wear this name of Christian with great pride and faithfulness. Sandra, in the name of Jesus Christ, remember your calling to be faithful to him alone. Remember your calling to turn from sin. Remember your calling to help to equip and edify the body of Jesus Christ, to listen to the power of the Spirit, to let the Spirit turn the pages of your life for the rest of your days. I pray for you in the name of Jesus as well, that as he reanoints you and rebuilds you and continues to receive your faith into him, that life would be miraculous for you, that you would find that in him is the only thing worth living and worth dying for. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray these vows that Sandra has said back to you, Lord, would be received well. We ask this in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, as we pause in this moment, as we find comfort in these pews and arrange our bodies, Lord, in such a way that we aren't distracted, we're not fidgeting, where we can just receive fully from you, we open our hands, our minds, our hearts, even our lungs to receive the fresh breath that you provide. We praise your name, Almighty God, in the name of Jesus, for giving us not just our first life, but our second life, our rebirth into faith. We thank you for the eternity to come, when we don't have to worry with the breaking down of the bodies that we've received this side of heaven, where indeed every tear will be wiped away, that loss and mourning will no longer be part of existence, where we can walk past things that have terrorized us, terrorized humanity forever. We can walk past these ancient, extinct forces, these fossils of sin, and point at them and say, wow, those sure used to be powerful. In Jesus' name, we pray for the life to come. And in the meantime, we pray that you give us the ability and the courage to live a life worthy of the calling of your Son Jesus this day. We pray a blessing this hour for everyone that we have on our prayer list who is in need of healing and of help. We pray for those, Lord, that are suffering in body. We pray, Lord, that you provide them the encouragement and the strength. As Isaiah 40 says, that they wake up every morning fully renewed with strength to face this day. We pray a blessing, Lord, on this congregation as we continue to grow and grow, not just in number, but in faith. We pray that your Spirit would find in us workable stewards. We pray that you would mold us into what you want us to be. It's in humility, Father, that we pray this prayer. In the name of Jesus, the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Please join me in singing our hymn of communion, The Old Rugged Cross, number 548, stanzas 1 and 4.
Thank you.
according to one of the accounts in the Gospels of this meal, the Last Supper of Jesus, which was the first supper for the church, Jesus began by gathering his disciples in this upper room, praying for them, teaching them a few things, and then he got on his knees and washed their feet. One of our own has had her feet washed today, and we rejoice in her renewal into faith in Jesus. We also remember that Jesus is pleased when he has an opportunity to come and serve us. As much as we, like Peter, want to say, "Lord, forbid it, no, I must wash your feet," Jesus says, "No, you must allow the Son of God to serve." So often we think of what we can do for Jesus. So often we think of what we can contribute. We come to this table not about us. We come reminded of what Jesus wants to do for us. Come with humility, but come as you are. At First Christian, we celebrate an open communion service, which means that if you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, regardless of your church membership, here or elsewhere, if you believe in the good confession, this meal is for you, and it's been prepared for you not just for today, but from the foundation of the world. For Jesus, on the night he was to be betrayed, after praying over his disciples, sat down for the meal. During the meal, he took a loaf of bread. He thanked God the Father for it. He blessed it. He broke it, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Eat of it, all of you. And every time that you gather and you eat from this bread, remember me." Let us pray.
Thank you, God, that we are here in your house, and you have blessed us by inviting us to your table in remembrance and honor of your Son, Jesus, who did die on the cross, his broken body given for the redemption of our sins, and the opportunity for everlasting life if we follow his teachings. We pray for your will in our life, not ours. It's in your Son's holy name we pray. Amen.
In a similar way, after the meal, Jesus took a cup of wine. He thanked God for it. He blessed it. And then he said, this cup is the new covenant that we have with God, and it is poured out in my blood for the forgiveness of sins for many people. Drink of it, all of you. And every time that you gather and you drink from this cup, remember me. Let us pray.
Loving Father, we approach your table with humble hearts and gladdened spirits to say thank you for our many, many blessings, the greatest being our salvation. The sacrifice of your Son on the cross made this possible, and every time we come to your table, we're reminded of that sacrifice. As we take this cup in remembrance, we ask your continued blessings for each of us. It is in the holy name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Friends, as we prepare to share from the cup, please join in the faith that we share in reciting John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The ushers will now come forward to collect our morning offering. Father Almighty, we continue to give you thanks and praise for your abundance shown toward us. Receive these gifts, Lord, as a reflection, Lord, of our faith toward you. We know we can't buy your grace. We're not attempting to. But we, in gratitude, return these to you, asking you to bless them and bless us in return. It's in the name of Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. You may be seated, and the children are invited forward for the children's moment.
Toby.
What's up, man? Doing all right? Come on down, guys. I really need y'all's help today. Wow, we got a good bunch of you guys. My goodness. All right. Guys, I really, really need your help today. Can y'all help me out? All right. Here's the deal. My wife gave me a very important job, all right? I have to make a very important decision. She asked me to choose what we're going to have for lunch today, okay? I'm not very good at these decisions, okay? So can I get one of y'all to help me? Well, here's the thing, all right? I would really like a hamburger. Hamburgers, they're tasty, they're really yummy. I like Sonic hamburgers. Fries, oh, fries are really good. McDonald's fries. But they're not really healthy, right? So, like, we're trying to be healthy, okay? So the other option maybe is just a salad. Maybe we should get some salad, right? Y'all like salad? Oh, yes, okay. And salads are healthy. There's not as much flavor, but, you know, they're still pretty good. So that's my dilemma. So maybe I have a coin here. Can anybody flip a coin for me? Yes? Okay. Let's have you flip it, okay? Now, hold on. If it's tails, I'm going to have a hamburger. If it's heads, I'll have a salad. Okay, let's see it. Let's see. Heads. Let's try it again. You want to flip it for me? All right, try it again. All right, what does it say? Heads. Let's move. I need to decide another way. Does anybody know eeny, meeny, miny, mo? Okay, can you do it with me? Ready? Eeny, meeny, miny, mo, catch a tiger by the toe. If he hollers, you will save $50 every day. My mother said to pick the very best one, and you are it. Salad. Well, maybe I put the decisions aside. You know, decisions are kind of hard sometimes, and I don't know what I'm going to eat for lunch today, but... You know, the question is, how does God want us to make decisions? You know, the Bible says something pretty interesting about that. It says that we are to seek and we will find. It says we are to ask and it will be given. And it says we are to knock and the door will be open. See, one way to do it, or to look at this, is to say, if we are to seek, maybe we are to look in the Bible for some good answers. And if we are to ask, maybe we should pray to God when we need a big decision made. And if we were to knock, we know that God's going to open the right door for us to go through and make the right decision. So maybe we should try making decisions God's way. Even though flipping a coin in eeny, meeny, miny, mo is fun sometimes, it's always not the best way to decide. Can y'all pray with me? Dear Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the many things you do for us. And we thank you for giving us... the right ways to decide things, God, and opening the right doors. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen. Can I have my coin back? Thank you.
This morning's scripture reading is from Mark 12, 12 through 17, and here begins the reading. When they realized that he had told this parable against them, they wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowd. So they left him and went away. Then they sent to him some Pharisees and some Herodians to trap him in what he said. And they came and said to him, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality, but teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not? Should we pay them or should we not?" But knowing their hypocrisy, he said to them, "Why are you putting me to the test? Bring me a denarius and let me see it." And they brought one. Then he said to them, "Whose head is this and whose title?" They answered, "The emperor's." Jesus said to them, "Give to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." And they were utterly amazed at him. The word of the Lord.
Our second reading is from Psalm 86, verses 11 through 12. May God add his blessing upon the reading, the hearing, and the understanding of these words. Teach me thy way, O Lord, that I may walk in thy truth. Unite my heart to fear thy name. I give thanks to thee, O Lord, my God, with my whole heart, and I will glorify thy name forever. We know these words to be trustworthy and true. Let us pray. Almighty God, we come again seeking to be fed by your word. And so we pray again that you pour into me the gift of preaching and you continue to anoint this congregation with a renewed hunger and thirst for your word alone. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. You will have trouble in this life. It's a direct quote from Jesus. You will have trouble in this life. Can I get an amen on that? Jesus taught throughout his scripture the real nitty-gritty of life, and that Christians, his followers, instead of being immune to it, in many cases, it attaches to us, walking the walk of Jesus. Being a countercultural movement necessarily will lead even further to trouble. Well, there's all sorts of trouble. One of the primary versions of trouble that you and I have inherited and lived through and probably can expect this week includes some sort of conflict or confrontation with another adult, a coworker, a family member, you name it. And what's interesting is not only are these confrontations and conflicts inevitable? They will come. You will face them. To add to this, the world has done an excellent job at discipling us. We've been trained from a young age how to respond to conflicts and confrontations. In fact, the two primary modes that we've been accustomed to and trained by, it's known as fight or flight. The first is let the adrenaline flow through you, pin your ears back, and get ready for a good old-fashioned squaring-off fight. When we are confronted or we are part of a confrontation, the first option is for us to feel fully authorized to create some sort of scorched earth scenario where we will lash out, we will win at all costs. The second is to flee. When faced with confrontations, we have been discipled, if you can't win the fight, circle the wagons, take the fetal position, suck your thumb until the weather has gone past you. Either way, it's all about survival. And the problem with both of those options that the world has done a very good job at teaching us is is that it narrows our vision. If you've ever been in a conflict, you know you get kind of tunnel vision. In both of those scenarios, fighting or fleeing, are all about us not maintaining any sort of sense of self-control. Whether you're coming at someone like a tornado of fingernails and elbows, or if you're running as fast as you can retreating, those are both not self-controlled responses. This morning begins a three-week sermon series based on not what the world teaches us about conflicts, but about what Jesus Christ teaches us about conflicts, about what he models for us, and about what the Holy Spirit's attempting to do through us, even in the midst of a tense situation, when the stakes are high, when the emotions are running. There's a story in today's scripture that we heard from Mark's gospel that Ainsley read for us. And the story has Jesus walking into the temple, and while he's in the temple, he is confronted by some Jewish leaders. Verse 12 mentions that the Jewish leaders were always looking for chances to get him, but they realized very wisely that their power was limited. They themselves couldn't do much. Their main inch of power had to do with connecting it to influencing other powerful people, and the two powerful groups that they hoped to influence were either the Roman government or the crowds. If they could get the Roman government to kill Jesus for them, which they finally did on a Roman cross, that would be one solution. On the other side would be for Jesus to lose his credibility with the crowd, or even better, for the crowds to turn against him and hurt him. You'll notice if you go back and study Mark chapter 12, verse 12, the first scripture verse for this day, or for today, it says that they withdrew from Jesus because they had great fear of the crowds. And so using these two options of influence, Jesus is approached by his accusers, and they walk up to him in the temple, and they give him a black and white question that should seal the deal for him. He should be discredited either about the government or from the crowd's perspective. And they go to Jesus and say, "Tell us, teacher, you are trustworthy and you never show difference to anybody and you speak the truth and your soul's not for sale. No one can pay you off or buy you out. And so we ask you this question, should we pay taxes to Caesar?" Black or white, yes or no, should we pay them or not? No more fence straddling, Jesus. Give us an answer. But Jesus looked at his accusers with the eyes that only Jesus has, and he asked a more important question. Why are you doing this? That's a good question. Why are you doing this? Who put you up to this? But then the scripture goes on, and he could have just sat with that question. He never gets an answer to his question, by the way. And he looks at the accusers with eyes that he has, that according to the scriptures, where he can see theirs and our hypocrisy. Hypocrisy. The Greek word for hypocrisy is a robust word, and it builds on an illusion or an image of somebody who's wearing a mask and putting on a play. Have you ever met a good actor, a professional? They really can get into that person. They can act that person out. But that character that they're playing is 0% connected to who they really are as a person. Jesus looks at these accusers and he recognizes hypocrites. He recognizes that this isn't really who they are. So what did Jesus see? What did Jesus see in them that guaranteed that he was in the stance and in the presence of hypocrites who were accusing him? We see in those days, to get around and to be able to survive economically or to be one of the friends of the Roman government and live at all in the land governed by the Romans, everyone used the same basic denominator of currency. Today it's folded money. Back then it was the denarius. The denarius was the most common coin carried in someone's pocket. It was useful, like what the American's Express credit card, don't leave home without it. You could take it wherever you were, anywhere in the government's land, anywhere in the empire, and a denarius would be recognized and would be useful. Which was very helpful because Rome was a vast empire, spanning all sorts of cultures and religions and languages. It was nice to have one common currency. The problem is, on the denarius itself was an image of Caesar. And if you've studied Scripture at all, you know how the Jews and how Yahweh feel about graven images, particularly graven images within the temple. And since this was a problem, the Jews created something called Hebraic temple coins. The Hebraic temple coins, I think we might have a picture, they might show it up here in a minute, but those coins had images of Moses, that's the bad coin, moving on to the second coin. Ooh, get that out of here. Maybe not. There's the good coin. Here's an image of the pillars of the temple. These were coins that were to be used in the temple. They were temple-friendly coins. You could bring them in without blaspheming because all the images on them were appropriate. And so there was some good news when you came to the temple, particularly from out of town. There would be tables set up outside. And I want you to remember this part of the sermon because we'll be referring to it in 2 weeks. These tables were convenient for all sorts of reasons. For instance, if you were traveling from far away, having a pilgrimage down from Galilee, for instance, like Jesus, and you needed to go to temple and worship God, and it's a religion that had animal sacrifices, instead of trying to find room in your minivan for a goat, you can buy a goat at the table when you get to the temple. Very convenient. And not only that, because the denarius was not money you were to take into the temple, it was blasphemous, you weren't to bear the image of anybody but Yahweh in the temple, they had money changers for you. You only brought the amount of money you needed, you would change it out, you would go into the temple, you would offer your animal sacrifice and your financial sacrifice back to God, you would come back, the extra money, you would turn it back in denarius, they solved the problem for you. Remember this, because we'll get to it in 2 weeks when Jesus does something to those tables. And so Jesus is standing in the temple, and these people come and approach him, and they're trying to trap him. He asks his question, "Why are you doing this?" But instead of waiting for an answer, he says, "Okay, let's get to your question first. Hand me a denarius. Who produced the coin? Who handed him the coin?" His accusers. Without ever opening his mouth, with that one move, Jesus of Nazareth completely made two hard statements. Number one, that you're asking me about carrying money that's owed to Caesar. I don't even have it. But you do. In addition to him saying, "I don't have that, I don't carry that, I don't work with that money on me, can you show me?" And they produced the coin in an instant. His accusers were discredited before their crowd. Whoa. And Jesus goes on. He says, "I want you to remember this. I want you to remember how you feel right now. And take this statement to heart. Give unto Caesar what is Caesar's, and render unto God what is God's." Now, I've heard this preached so many times. I know people pull this out as ammunition against why we shouldn't pay taxes. And that if that's what the scripture means, that's not what it means. It's helpful. I don't like paying taxes either. But it's deeper than that. You see, Jesus looked at those crowds at his accusers, as he did so many times. He looked at the people who were trying to trap him, and with truth and with love, he looked at them and said, "You're playing a dangerous game, my friends. You're trying to trap me, I can't be bought. You try to bury me, I'll be back up in 3 days. Don't worry about me, I'm worried about you." He looked at them and said, "Do not play this game. Because according to your actions, according to what you're carrying in your pocket, and according to what you're doing to me, says Jesus, you have not been able to establish who's prime in your life. By your actions, you recognize the power of Rome categorically, and you leave your religion up to Yahweh. You go to Rome when you need something done, but you go to Yahweh when you want to look religious. You go to Rome when you want to move mountains, but you go to God when you want to find justification for your actions. Friends, the day is coming when you will be cast to Rome or to God. Go to God. This isn't about taxes. It's about life. Render unto Yahweh what is Yahweh's, and render unto the Roman government what's the Roman government. But don't straddle that fence, friends, and don't you come and try to attack me, says Jesus. And the last thing that's in this story, it says that the accusers themselves stood there and were amazed. I've heard this story preached and taught so many times different ways. I wondered why they were so amazed. And when I figured out it had to do with the discrediting of the coins, I thought, oh, well, that's probably why. And so this morning, as we begin this sermon series on dealing with confrontations and on conflicts, we're going to take 3 weeks at a time and look at a different side of using the pattern of Jesus for our own lives. But before we take another step, y'all know me, and I know you fairly well, and you know that if you're in the midst of a conflict and something's bubbling up and you can't seem to handle it, you know what I'm going to tell you to do. To pray. If you know me well enough, you know that I'll say, pray for 2 weeks, 5 minutes a day, out loud, for the person who is just your accuser, your enemy. Pray for their Holy Spirit to fill them. Pray for their physical body. Pray that their money situation's taken care of. Pray for their relationships to be healed and mended. And pray that God shines through them. First 3 days, it's doing it through gritted teeth. You don't want to do it. But you also don't want to go exercise. It's good for you. But in addition to blessing our enemies, which is what Jesus teaches very strictly, and St. Paul, bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse. In addition to blessing, there are times when a conflict becomes a real live ammunition scenario, where you have to behave before your enemies outside of your prayer closet. And if you don't hear anything from these next three sermons, I want you to hear this. God the Father is not interested in winners and losers. He's not interested in transferring power and influence and pride from one person to another or back and forth. God the Father doesn't believe in that type of justice. Read Jesus. What God the Father is interested in any and all circumstances, including in heightened, conflicted situations, is that the Holy Spirit would get hold of everyone involved, and that everybody would be transformed, and that everybody would win, and that God's kingdom would come on earth as it is in heaven. You see how well we've been discipled by the world? One of my favorite Christian ethicists, Howard Yoder, for you Mennonite fans out there, taught jokingly that the last 100 years of Christian ethics was the study of how to not take Jesus seriously. Because we've been so well discipled by this world. Because we've already been trained, we already think we know what we want, what we want to hear. We've been coached. You know how hard it is to coach someone new who's already been coached? That's us. And so Jesus and the Father and the Holy Spirit are in line right now trying to get a hold of you, all of you, not just the good you, but the you that lives in conflict, and trying to find ways to use your conflict for his kingdom. That he'll bring people into your life in broken scenarios that in the world's eyes are your enemies, but in Jesus' eyes could become a sister or brother to you through this process. That's miraculous. That's of the kingdom of God. And so this morning, there are several things we can take from today's story, but I'd like to focus on one as a strategy, as a calling to what we are as Christians in the midst of conflict. And it's the calling that Jesus models for us to live lives worthy of the calling of the Son of God, for us to live lives as if Jesus has actually died for us, has actually washed our feet and dunked us in the water, has rained down through us, and is prepared to do anything he can to get us and to hold us and to embrace us, to live lives worthy of that calling, to walk in paths of righteousness. Not self-righteousness, but just do what God tells you to do. In today's story, don't walk in the temple with denarius in your pocket. Set aside those addictions. Say no more to the things that could discredit you. Walk away from the issues in our lives and own up to our past mistakes and seek forgiveness and say, I know I've done wrong, but Father, forgive me, and church, please walk with me and be my church. You will face a confrontation. It's not an if to win. And as Christians, we're called to walk in paths of righteousness for one basic purpose, and that's because if and when you find yourself in the midst of a confrontation and you don't have the denariuses in your pocket and someone comes and puts a finger in your face and starts accusing you of this and that, when you have been walking in the right path as best the Holy Spirit can lead you through, you are now no longer in a defensive mindset when someone comes up to attack. You are now in the position, like Jesus teaches, where you can be in the midst of an accuser, of an attack, and ask the primary question. Instead of defending yourself, saying, oh, well, no, that's not true, and why are you trying to, instead, you get to step back and not be defensive, to say a brief prayer in your heart to the Holy Spirit, and then ask, either out loud or in your actions, what's wrong with this person? Or in Jesus' words, why are you trying to trap me? Or as I say, what's going on? Jesus has a goal to use us in any and all situations, and if we are geared toward defending ourselves instead of the truth defending us, we will miss out every single time on what he's trying to do. In the midst of a conflict, be prepared to live in that moment. Don't run. Don't fight. Pray and stand and deliver. You see, because the world doesn't need more confrontational people, you know. And the world also doesn't need more defensive people. The world needs more Holy Spirit gospel bearers in this world who will be in the trenches, even in places that scare everyone else to death. May God have sovereignty over you, including when you stand in the midst of a conflict. I say this in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My friends, if we stand and sing our closing hymn, I believe it is Trust and Obey, stanzas 1, 3, and 4, that's 5, 5, 6. This is your opportunity if anyone would like to come forward and formally join our fellowship at First Christian, or if you'd like to come forward for prayer and to rededicate your life to Jesus. And most importantly, if there's anyone here who has never accepted Jesus or publicly proclaimed him as Lord and Savior, this is a great opportunity for you to come forward and do that. Please rise.
We do.
Would you please be seated? We've got some good news. Lyle and Rena. Friends, this is Lyle and Rena Mashburn. They've been disciples for how many years? A good
nine
years. And Rena's our good closet Baptist. They've come forward to place their membership with us. And they come to us from Community Christian Church. Rena and Lyle, I'm going to ask you the same question you were asked when you were baptized. Rena, do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God? And do you profess him as Lord and Savior?
Yes, I do.
God bless you. Lyle, do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God? And do you profess him as Lord and Savior?
I do.
God bless you both. Church, would you please rise? And join me as we welcome the Mashburn family. As we begin by saying, reaffirming our own faith in Jesus the Christ, we gladly welcome you into this community of faith, enfolding you with our love and committing ourselves to your care. In the power of God's Spirit, let us mutually encourage each other to trust God and strengthen one another to serve others, that Christ's church may in all things stand faithful. God bless you both. Welcome home.
Thank you.
Brad, would you mind? Brad's going to take the Mashburns back so we can give them handshakes and hugs after our service. Got a few pieces of information for you before we have our benediction. The first is that next Sunday during the Sunday school hour from 10:15 to 10:45 in Kirkendall Hall, we're having a State of the Church address. It's first ever. It's where you're going to hear from, briefly, don't worry, from me, from our board chair, Carol Berry, and our chair of the elders, Brad Payne. And it's a time just to share about the future of our church, where we've come from, where we're going, and get excited together. Also, next a week from this Wednesday begins our Wednesday night church here in the sanctuary from 6 to 7. It's a worship service with a sermon different from Sunday. There'll be communion and prayers and all the work. So it's a midweek peek for you. Jonna Russell, are you with us today? She's upstairs. There she comes. Wanted to make sure you got to meet Jonna Russell. While she's heading up, I'm going to make one announcement, our last announcement now, which is you'll notice in your bulletin, there's an insert for the seven principles, the Gottman seven principles for strong marriages. We have sign-up sheets in the office. Please consider taking this class. It's an excellent course that we're offering here in October. Jonna has joined our team back in August, and I wanted you all to see her up front and center. She's wearing two major hats in the church. She's our membership admin, which means that she's the one that you can call to set up appointments, and you'll be getting a lot of calls from her to update our roster. In addition, she's also wearing the hat of our college pastor and director, and under her leadership, the first 2 weeks, we about doubled in student numbers in our college ministry. So she's a born and bred disciple from San Angelo, Texas, and we're glad to have her. So she'll be joining us up in the back, too. Please join me now for our benediction. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance and shine upon you and give you the peace and the grace of his Son, Jesus Christ. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen.